Okay, so we have looked at what operators are on an abstract linear vectors space. Operators take vectors and give you other vectors, and then we've looked at what linear operators are, right? So they obey the principle of superposition. Now we will discuss an aspect which is central to there are a set of topics that we've been covering, namely eigenvalues and eigenvectors, right? So perhaps you might be familiar with this notion in the context of matrices, but we will define it from the point of view of an abstract linear vector, right? And then we will see how this is connected to eigenvalues and eigenvectors of matrices later on during the course of our discussion. Okay, so let A be some linear operator which is defined on some vector space V. If you are able to find some non-null vector X, such that if you operate with A on X, it must give you back the same vector itself, subject to some coefficient, which is called eigenvalue, right? If you are able to find such a vector, then it's called eigenvector, and lambda could in general be some complex number, and the lambda would be called an eigenvalue corresponding to that eigenvector X. Now, if you find all eigenvalues corresponding to some operator A, then you call it the spectrum of that operator A, right? So the eigenvector, right, is subject to some factor. So you can clearly see that if X is an eigenvector, so is alpha times X for any arbitrary complex number, right? You can put alpha on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side, nothing changes. Eigenvalue remains lambda. So typically, we tend to look at all these, alpha X's as really the same, right? So you don't make a distinction between X and alpha X. If X is an eigenvector, then so is alpha X. That's not a distinct eigenvector, right? But given, there are cases where you can have for the same eigenvalue multiple linearly independent eigenvectors, but we are getting ahead of ourselves. So I'm just telling you at this point that if you have an eigenvector X, then so is alpha times X, and that's also a kind of a trivial kind of lot of different vectors being an eigenvector, but you tend to think of all of them as the same, really. So let's look at a few examples, right? So at this point, we are still thinking of these vectors are as abstract vectors, and also these operators are as abstract operators. So let's consider some, let V be the real 3D vector space, and let me think of this operation R that flips the X and Y components but leaves the Z component unchanged. So its action on, all the vectors can be entirely defined by just defining its operation on the unit vector. So let's look at EX, EY, and EZ. So it will operate on EX and give you EY, or it operates on EY and will give you EX, and when it operates on EZ, it just returns EZ. So in general, if it acts on some vector A is equal to A1 EX plus A2 EY plus A3 EZ, then you would get A2 EX plus A1 EY plus A3 EZ, right? So it's obvious that EZ is an eigenvector, right? From the definition itself, you see that R acting on EZ gives you EZ. So nothing changes. So therefore, its EZ is one eigenvector with eigenvalue 1. But there are two more eigenvectors for this linear operator, right? You might be able to quickly look at the structure and guess what this is. Indeed, so EX plus EY and EX minus EY are eigenvectors, as you can check. One of them has eigenvalue 1 and the other one has eigenvalue minus 1, because R acting on EX plus EY will just give you EX plus EY, but R acting on EX minus EY will give you minus EX minus EY. Right, so this is one example, but let's look at another example where we consider, an abstract linear vector space made up of differentiable complex functions of a single variable X, and let's consider d by dx as the operator, right? And then, so you're looking for, eigenvector. So d by dx acting upon some vector must give you the same vector times some constant. So you can check that if you consider the function e to the kx, you will get k times e to the kx. Now k can be some arbitrary complex number, right, in general, and it will give you eigenvalue k, right? I have just considered two examples to illustrate that you have, your operators can be very abstract in nature and can come from many different formulations of a linear vector space, and still this notion of eigenvalue, eigenvector are defined, right? So later on we will see that, considering matrices and their eigenvectors and eigenvalues, like most of us are already familiar with, there is a close connection between this and that, particularly in the context of finite dimensional linear vector spaces, but that's coming a bit later. So let's look at some immediate consequences of this definition, right? One is pertains to the identity operator, right? So the identity operator, whenever it acts on any non-null vector, it must return the same vector. So that's really the same as the definition of this eigenvalue. It says, what it says is the identity operator is, every non-null vector is an eigenvector of the identity operator with eigenvalue 1, right? So and also there is a consequence of the definition is that the identity operator can have no other eigenvalue, because every non-null vector will give you back the same vector itself when you operate with I. So you have only one as eigenvalue and there is no other eigenvalue. And any operator that has every non-null vector as an eigenvector must be the identity operator or a multiple of it, right? And if you say that eigenvalues are unity, then it is the identity operator, right? So I mean, we saw that the identity operator has this decomposition. You could write it as e1 e1 plus e2 e2 so on in some basis, and then we argued that I acting up the way we showed that this operator in this outer product form, right, is the identity operator a few lectures ago, was to show that it, whenever it operates on any basis vector, it gave you, it returned the same value, same vector, and therefore it would give you the same vector for any arbitrary vector, right? So these are all very direct consequences of the definition of the identity operator. So also it follows from this definition that if the spectrum of some operator A is lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 2, lambda n, the spectrum of the mth power A to the m is going to be A lambda 1 to the m, lambda 2 to the m, so on, as you can verify, right? You operate with A on x gives you lambda x. If you again bring another A from the left side, you have A squared acting on lambda on x is equal to lambda squared acting on x, and then lambda cube, so on, right? Every time you bring in another factor A, that will give you an extra factor of lambda. And so each eigenvector of A to the m is also an eigenvector of each eigenvector of A so each eigenvector of A is also an eigenvector of A to the m. So that's a correction I have to make, but the converse is not true, right? You can find an example, right? So I mean, one way to immediately see this is if A, if you have an eigenvector of x, so you have Ax is equal to lambda x. So A to the power m, every time you'll keep on getting, you'll get back the same vector, if you no matter how many A's you put in, right? But if you have found one eigenvector for A to the m, it doesn't mean that it's going to be an eigenvector of A. So the simplest way to test this is to come up with an example, which you can do. If you consider a, think of a 2x2 matrix. That's the simplest way, right? You can think of more complicated abstract operators, but think of a 2x2 matrix and show, just one counter example where A squared has a certain eigenvector, but it's not going to be an eigenvector of A. Maybe this can be a homework problem which I will assign at a later time. But this is a quick introduction to the notion of eigenvalues and eigenvectors for linear operators on linear vector space. Thank you.